Financial institutions deal with data. Correction, a lot of data, which is why it's critical they're compliant and aware of the risk. But data also represents a critical edge for these institutions, and innovative companies like Ayasdi are helping exploit that data advantage through AI. Welcome to the FinTech Effect, RegTech Edition.
David, thanks for joining me today.
Thank you, Lloyd. Pleasure to be here.
Ayasdi is one of the most decorated companies in the AI space. What do you attribute the success to?
It's a combination of things, right? If I look at the backbone of it, it's our topological data analysis, also known as TDA, but combine it with unsupervised machine learning, which we find very effective in terms of allowing the data itself to show us what the behaviors really are versus using more of a supervised machine learning process. In there, you make a set of assumptions which can actually taint the actual results further on. Justification is another big area for us. There's a lot of solutions out there today that are very much black box. We're all about transparency. And where that comes into play, obviously, is in highly regulated environments, as well as other environments as well, but in particular, highly regulated environments.
So what kind of applications are you building in the financial services space?
Well, certainly we're looking at fin crimes in particular is a big priority for us, but we're looking at things around customer intelligence. So when we look at customer intelligence, that's really looking at things like customer churn. So being able to say, XYZ customers are going to leave the bank, and here's why. We also have something that focuses on customer complaints. So we can actually tell a bank, a financial institution, that a customer is going to complain and why. So those are the three areas that we're really doing a lot of focus on. And we're also starting to get a little bit into risk and fraud and cyber as well.
AML in particular has attracted a lot of attention from the AI community. What are the big opportunities there?
This is absolutely a huge passion for me. I've led consulting organizations around things like fin crimes, AML fraud, and whatnot. I used to actually partner with Ayasdi, but their technology really attracted me so much that I actually decided to join them versus leading a consulting practice. So I have a lot of passion in this area. So from an AML perspective, where we do a lot of focus is first customer segmentation, where we're actually being able to understand the risk of a client more on an actual basis versus when they're onboarded. When they're onboarded into the bank, generally speaking, there's a lot of assumed factors that go into risk rating them. We look at it from an actual perspective. Once they get in, they're transacting and whatnot. So that's one particular area which has helped further down the line in transaction monitoring to reduce false positives. Another area we're very focused on, which is almost like an automatic outgrowth of that, is things like change in behavior. So while your transaction monitoring systems look at change in behavior, they're rules-based and they're very much one-dimensional. When you look at our solution, it's really focused on when a client moves from segment to segment, that could be very interesting. So that could be an indicator of some significant issues from a money laundering perspective. Another area that kind of grew out of that is a challenger model to the customer due diligence process. Again, very much the factors as part of customer due diligence are very much assumed when the client comes through the door and they're answering questions for you. You don't know that that's actually the behaviors that are going to happen. And then the final area that we're looking at is something that we call intelligent alerts, which is once an alert comes out of a transaction monitoring system, we can help you kind of prioritize those alerts and risk rate them based upon the actual behaviors that are going on. Transaction monitoring systems today do have change in behavior scenarios, but again, those rules-based systems are very one-dimensional. They don't get down to the depth and the permutations of things that could happen in terms of behavior.
So what are some other areas you think that lend themselves to intelligent applications?
Now, it's interesting you say that, and to me, it's almost infinity, right? It's really about leveraging the value of what our platform does. I might have mentioned it earlier that we put applications on top of our platform for various business lines and whatnot. So if you look at any sort of bank financial service organization, if I take, let's say, HSBC and Citi, for example, if you look at the number of applications they have, I think HSBC is somewhere in the vicinity of 4,000 to 5,000 different applications running. City, it's about 6,000 or 7,000. So when I look at this, I say it's all about where can we add value, which is almost in an infinite number of areas, even beyond what we've talked about already in terms of financial crimes, customer intelligence. I use the examples of churn and customer complaints. But if you look at it from a marketing perspective, you know, suggesting different products and services or suites of products and services to clients, we're very well placed to do that as well.
Yeah, that's huge. Well, I'd love to see how it works.
Great. Why don't we look at the demo? So what we're seeing here basically is our landing screen. So this would be really more for what I'd call an admin type of function. They could be part of your FIU, or it could be more of an analytics type of person. Because what we're seeing here really is more about performing the segmentation before it gets into your transaction monitoring system. So here what we would do is the first thing we'd look at is importing the data. In terms of the data for the segmentation, you know, we have various areas that we could, data sets that we could import in. So it could be just the transactions, KYC, previous alerts and their dispositioning. In terms of files, you know, CSV is one particular choice, but we have several different file types that you could load up. Adding different beyond this is also definitely possible as well. So what we would do is, once we say pick the transactions, we'd continue on to at least a preview of what the schema would look like. So in terms of here, there's a set of transactions, you'll see things like amounts and dates and whatnot. And then what we would go on is to do the data profiling, which, you know, would bring us here. And what you're seeing here is, from a data profiling perspective, in the top left corner, you're looking at customers per country. On the right-hand corner, you're looking more at transactions per country. And then ultimately, you're looking about a distribution of the transaction amounts across the different transactions that have been executed. And then we go on to preparing that data. What you see here actually is what I'll call is similar to what you'd see in terms of the AML flow. So you see the data sources. Typically, what happens at financial institutions, those data sources would make their way into a transaction monitoring system. Our transaction segmentation, which is what we're kind of looking at right now, sits in between, right? And that's where we do that kind of real profiling in terms of the behaviors. So we'd also be able to go on in terms of feature exclusion. So in terms of features, you can sit here and decide if there's certain types of features that you want to include slash exclude. And here it's really about excluding different types of data that you may not want to use in terms of the model. And there could be various reasons why you may want to do that. But once you've done that, you can click on any one of those or all of them and do that exclusion. For this purposes here, I wouldn't necessarily exclude any, but just continue on to the actual feature selection. And what this does is it summarizes for you, basically, here's the number that has been excluded. Here's what we've generated in terms of running the model and building the profile. We have an overall number of features, but then the final features is what's below. So, you know, essentially it's after you've excluded a set of those features. This view is, it gives you a view of each of the segments. Again, it has the distribution. And if you were to click on each one of these, it brings you to the topological network, right? That particular network inside there. And then it tells you basically the top, quantitative and qualitative reasons as to what's behind that particular segment. And then it also outlines for you the decision tree that goes into, making those segments. After you've done the segmentation, you can then go down to the segmentation analysis. When we run the analysis, this is where we get to the point of change in behavior, right? Which I think I've mentioned previously. If you look at change in behavior in the traditional transaction monitoring systems today, they're very much one-dimensional. And so this gets down to a much granular level of detail. This is where someone may have moved from one segment to another one, which in turn usually generates quite a bit of interest. And then it goes through the different features that kind of have driven that change in terms of that that change in segments.
Well, there's no sign that Ayasdi is slowing down anytime soon, so thanks for taking the time.
No, thank you. I appreciate it.